Hi, I'm Dr. Michelle Kittleson, a heart failure transplant cardiologist at Cedars-Sinai in Los Angeles, California. While I wasn't lucky enough to attend ESC 2025 in person in Madrid, I was lucky enough to be able to absorb the excitement from many practice-changing trials, and I'll highlight four here. Let's start with beta blockers after myocardial infarction. They are considered a stalwart of management, but this is based more on tradition than evidence, as the foundational trials were conducted in the 1980s, prior to the current era of routine reperfusion, invasive management, antiplatelet therapies, and statins. In REBOOT-CNIC, about 8,000 patients with acute MI and EF greater than 40% were randomized to beta blocker versus placebo. Over a median follow-up of 3.7 years, there was no difference in the primary composite endpoint of death from any cause, reinfarction, or heart failure hospitalization. A nail in the coffin for routine use of beta blockers post-myocardial infarction. But because science is always interesting, another late-breaking beta blocker trial was also presented at ESC, BETAMI-DANBLOCK. In this trial, about 5,500 patients with acute MI and EF greater than 40% were randomized to beta blocker versus placebo. Over a median follow-up of 3.5 years, there was a significant 2% absolute risk reduction in the primary endpoint of death or major adverse cardiac events driven by a reduction in recurrent MI 5 versus 6.7%. So how do we reconcile these trials, which essentially had the same inclusion criteria, along with other large contemporary beta blocker post-MI trials like Reduce AMI, which was published in 2024? You may recall that Reduce AMI randomized about 5,000 patients post-acute MI with EF 50% or greater to beta blocker versus placebo, and over a median follow-up of 3.5 years, there was no difference in the primary composite endpoint of death or new MI. So we have two negative trials, REBOOT-CNIC and Reduce AMI, one positive trial, BETAMI-DANBLOCK, though the magnitude of benefit in this latter trial is small. So what should you tell your patient who suffered an acute MI? Let them know their timing is great. We have far more to offer than we did in the 1980s. And if they focus their efforts on things that really count, smoking cessation, exercise, achieving a healthy weight, keeping their blood pressure less than 130 over 80 and their LDL less than 55, they will be doing everything in their power to prevent a future cardiac event. What about when they ask about beta blockers? I'm a heart failure transplant cardiologist. So of course, the answer is a resounding yes if you have an ejection fraction under 40%. It is one of the essential pillars for heart failure with reduced ejection fraction. But for your patient with an EF of 40% or less, beta blockers will reduce the risk of heart failure hospitalizations and increase survival, potentially contribute to an improvement in ejection fraction. But remember that for your patient post-acute MI, there is no evidence to support routine use of beta blocker. And also remember that not all heart failure is created equal. Patients with HFpEF or restrictive cardiomyopathies, particularly cardiac amyloidosis, beta blockers do not improve outcomes and can worsen quality of life. So I had to veer into heart failure management because that's my specialty. So let's turn our attention to a heart failure trial. Let's turn our attention to cardiac glycoside therapy. Digitoxin, named for the finger-like flowers of the foxglove plant, was once one of the few effective medications available for patients with heart failure. The DITCH trial, published in 1997, demonstrated that digoxin reduced the risk of heart failure hospitalizations in individuals with heart failure. Post hoc analyses indicated an interaction between digoxin levels and outcomes. Lower digoxin levels improved survival, while higher levels associated with worse survival. However, digoxin receives a weak Class 2B indication in the 2022 ACC, AHA, HFSA heart failure guidelines because there are so many newer, shinier, more effective medications that have entered the chat. In essence, 1997 was a long time ago. Now this question has been revisited in the DIGIT-HF trial. The authors examined digitoxin, a related cardiac glycoside, which offers benefits of stable levels regardless of kidney function. About 1,200 patients with heart failure and EF 40% or less were randomized to digitoxin versus placebo. Over mean follow-up of 36 months, digitoxin reduced the risk of the primary composite endpoint of all-cause mortality and heart failure hospitalization driven by a decrease in heart failure hospitalization. First, the author should be congratulated on performing a much-needed study of a generic medication. It's refreshing because it's aimed at addressing an evidence gap rather than approval of a novel medication, as economics often prioritize the latter goal over the former. But the major question is, should this change practice? A few points to mention. Number one, the effect size was not necessarily impressive. An absolute 2% reduction in death, which was not significant, a significant 2% reduction in heart failure hospitalization, so not terrific magnitude of benefit on the background of other effective therapy. There were almost twice as many serious adverse events in the digitoxin group. And interestingly, the survival curves for both death and heart failure hospitalization come together at the end of the study period, which is interesting. Now, the benefit appears through year 4 visually, but perhaps it's impressive that they even extended the survival curves through year 9, and maybe no heart failure therapy should truly garner benefit at that stage. The subgroup analysis also indicate that there was benefit in those without versus with ICDs. Now, subgroup analyses are inherently hypothesis generating, but it makes me wonder what the mechanisms of death were. So bottom line, I'm glad they did the study, but I'm not sure the absolute effect size should change management. Patients are already at risk for polypharmacy, and quadruple therapy remains challenging to implement in heart failure with reduced ejection fraction. For now, I would spend my energy achieving target doses of the angiotensin receptor neprilysin inhibitor, evidence-based beta blocker, mineralocorticoid antagonist, and SGLT2 inhibitor, also recognizing that digitoxin in particular is not available currently to clinicians in the United States. Finally, let's end with the AQUATIC trial. I have no disclosures, but I do have a disclaimer. I'm a sucker for less is more. Every intervention has potential harm, so it's always refreshing to be able to deprescribe and reduce harm. The AQUATIC HF trial addressed this. It randomized about 800 patients with chronic coronary artery disease, all had had stents, but greater than 6 months prior to enrollment, and an indication for long-term anticoagulation, about 90% with atrial fibrillation, to aspirin or placebo, along with their anticoagulation therapy. Over a median follow-up of 2.2 years, stopped early because of harm in the aspirin arm, patients receiving aspirin had a 50% higher risk of the primary composite endpoint. More importantly, there was an 80% increased risk of net adverse clinical event in patients receiving aspirin comprised of death, atheroembolic cardiovascular event, or major bleeding. Is there a theme today? I think there is. Think twice about beta blockers post-MI. Think 3 times about patients receiving aspirin if they have chronic coronary disease and are on anticoagulation. And reserve your judgment for digitoxin if available for your patients with HFrEF. There you have it, ESC 2025. Thanks so much for your attention.